Good evening, everybody. We are so happy to welcome you to this special concert with our UVA University singers. My name is Michael Slott. I'm the director of choral music here. And we are extremely excited that we've been able to have this week a very special residency with our guest composer, Mr. Ēriks Ešenvalds. Mr. Ešenvalds is really world famous at the moment, but I think the better introduction is what you just heard. You can hear that he has a stunning compositional voice, and so we are so thrilled that he's come all the way from Latvia to be with us this week. We have some special other guests I will introduce later. I'm actually happy to tell you that we have the ambassador and his wife from Latvia to the United States with us this evening as well. And I will introduce them. Say a word about that later on. But I can tell you, we've had the most wonderful week with Mr. Ešenvalds, working with our students, coaching us on his music, conducting them, talking to composition students and other students here. Today is actually, you probably know this, Thomas Jefferson's birthday. And I think he would be very happy to see that kind of artistic education taking place at his institution. So I just point that out. We're going to continue on with the program. It's not all Ešenvalds, actually. And so you'll hear some other pieces. Hopefully everybody has a program. We say welcome to our live stream audience as well. We'll continue on and we'll say a few words as we go here and there. The next piece is going to be by a Finnish composer, Mante Jarmi, and it's called Pukra S.
Amen. I'll be sharing with you Postlude by Rita Dove, a poem that inspired our next piece, Testimony by Richard Daniel Poor and Rita Dove. You prefer me invisible, no more than a crisp salute far away from your silks and firewood and woolens out of sight. I'm merely an annoyance. One slim, obstinate wrinkle in night's deepening trance. When sleep fails, you wish me shushed and back in my hole. As usual, you're not listening. Time stops only if you stop long enough to hear it passing. This is my business. I've got 10 weeks left to croon through. What you hear is a lifetime of song.
Thank you.
So while we're just quickly changing the stage, I'll tell you that actually, thank you, we've been blessed to not work with just one composer, but three composers in the last few weeks. As some of you may know, Richard Danielport, a very distinguished American composer, was here in town several weeks ago for a whole other piece set to read a dub text with Susan Graham, a very well-known mezzo-soprano here singing, and the Copland House musicians. And because he was coming, you know, I'm kind of always looking for an opportunity, and I said, well, maybe we could program a piece of his and then he could work with the singers on his piece, and that's exactly what we did. So he workshopped that piece you just heard with them a few weeks ago. And we're very happy to do it because, as you know, Rita Dunn is one of our all-star faculty members, our Pulitzer Prize-winning former U.S. Poet Laureate, member of the English faculty right next door. Next, we're going to do a piece by Jake Runestad, American composer. We have Zoomed with him before during the pandemic. This is a very interesting piece. It's called As Silence Haunts Me. It is based on the letter that Beethoven wrote to his brothers about his oncoming deafness. And of course, he was despairing in some way at that point. and Jake Runestad got the Brock Commission, which is ACE, the American Choral Director Association's big annual commission. He asked someone to write a libretto that could kind of dramatize that text of Beethoven expressing this deafness. And so what you will hear is a piece that uses Beethoven's own music, but starts to imagine what would it sound like if your hearing was a little bit off and starting to go. And you will hear dissonances that you don't expect in music that is otherwise familiar. Now, I want to point out one other thing. If you follow another group I work with in town, the Oratorio Society, you'll know that we're doing Beethoven's Ninth next month, the finale, and also other Beethoven works. The reason is it will be almost 200 years to the day in 1824 when Beethoven's Ninth was first heard by the world, and that's why we're doing it. But I thought it'd be so fascinating here. You'll hear in this piece also just quotes, intimations of the Ninth Symphony. So you can listen for that too. The piece has a very remarkable effect at the end. I'll let you see that for yourself. No spoiler alerts. We have our wonderful pianist, Deep Polifka, joining us. As I said, we've had three composers work with us. And the third one is one of our own grad students, Kristen Haig, who wrote a piece when she was an undergrad student at Princeton, and now she is here at UVA, and I think she is with us. Kristen, are you out there? Where is Kristen? Kristen has an interest, happily, in writing for chorus, and she showed me some of her pieces, and so we're going to do for you now this piece called On Children. So before, oh, by the way, Kristen, thank you so much for that lovely piece. We're trying to do it again for you too as well at some point. So nice to have you here at UVA. Before we do the last piece of the first half, I have just a couple special announcements, and then we will take a brief intermission, and then we're going to have, with full orchestra and soloists and the university singers, the North American premiere of the Ešenvalds Passion According to St. Luke. Extremely powerful and beautiful piece, and so you'll be the first people on this continent to hear it live. Hopefully not the last. It is a very, very good piece. I want to pass out a few thank yous without whom these kind of evenings and events would not be possible. First of all, as you hear a lot of times when you go to arts events here in town, the Cornell Memorial Foundation, they are tremendous supporters of so many facets of the arts. I don't know, is Melissa Young or Joe Ehrman here tonight? I don't know as they are, but we thank them anyways for all their tremendous support. We're very grateful to the UVA Family Program, Parents Program, which gives grants to student projects, student and faculty projects, as this is one. And they have also supported this concert. And of course, we're grateful to the Department of Music and to the College of Arts and Sciences here at UVA, which supports our endeavors. We have many family, friend, and alumni donors and supporters who help us along the way, and there is a special one here tonight, and I would like to invite him to the stage, and you'll hear why in a minute. Is Mr. Dennis Tosh here? Dennis, are you out there? Please come on out, Dennis. So, Dennis Tosh is one of those rare breed. He is, I think if I did my homework correctly, a triple who, which means he has 3 degrees from UVA. One of them, I think, is in music. Is that right? No? What was undergrad?
English.
English.
English and religious studies undergrad, English graduate school.
And then law. Yes, law school. And he sang, whether or not music major, you sang at University Singers during his time. I am very happy to tell you this evening a significant endowed fund for the UVA Choral Program through his estate, which will create income for this program and our activities in perpetuity, which means it will benefit the students who will come after these ones here on stage. But as you can imagine, it will continue to make opportunities like tonight possible. So could you all please join me in giving this time? Some of the people, as I look up at this group, have been in the group 8 semesters, and if you do the math, it means I have auditioned them on Zoom because it was the pandemic when they didn't really have a group to sing with for much of that first year. So, and they've been here the whole time. Amazing, amazing thing. So congrats to all of you. And officers raise their hand. lot of storylines, I guess you could say, on stage tonight. Greta Marl is our president. She was elected by her peers last spring to serve as the president of this group. Wonderful soprano. Greta was in an incredibly bad car accident a few months ago. In my opinion, it's a miracle that we have her with us, and I'm so grateful that we do. And here she is back on stage with us for the first time. Ešenvalds has come to us all the way from Latvia, where I am sure he is a jewel in the crown of his country. I took the chance, since we are close to Washington, D.C., to reach out to the Latvian embassy to see if they could send someone to be with us. And we are very honored that we have here tonight Ambassador Mari Selga, his spouse Marika Selga, the ambassador to the United States from Latvia. Steal all his hoodies, so he may not have that long, but hopefully he'll have it. But because this has been such a special week, having this, what I would call a very thoughtful, deep artist who also has a very wonderful sense of humor, join us for the week. We wanted to just give him a few presents on behalf of the University Singers. I don't know if you can fit this on the plane. Thank you.
retreats from Virginia to remind you of this place. We're so grateful of all that you have given to us. It's truly been a magical experience, and this couldn't even begin to describe how wonderful this has been for us. So thank you.
Special moment. We've invited back alumni who sang Only in Sleep with us during the 2018-2019 year. We took it on tour. We have one of the solos from that time. Faith Suri has come all the way from Montana to sing again. And I'm very happy to tell you, and by the way, we have a great second half, so come back for that. And Mr. Ešenvalds will tell you a little about his piece at the top of the second half. But right now, I'm happy to tell you that the alumni and university singers will be conducted by Mr. Ešenvalds in his own hands. So, welcome back to the second half of this special North American premiere of Mr. Ešenvalds' Passion According to St. Luke. By the way, I got very interesting news at intermission. UVA is a very interesting place. I learned that we have here tonight the first U.S. ambassador to Latvia when we normalized relations in the early 90s. If you're here, Mr. Asilnis, I think, is welcome. Senior students, we'll have a small reception up here in the lobby and into room 107 after the concert, and of course for our alumni seniors here as well. Thank you for being with us. And now I want to just thank you again for joining us for this special occasion and turn it over to Ēriks Ešenvalds to tell you about the music.
Thank you. I myself was a singer, and I sang first tenor in a professional state choir Latvia for 9 years. And I remember that the most hardest moments for the singers were to be on the risers during the speeches. So my speech will be, let's say, 2 minutes. In 1994, I graduated from high school and I entered Latvian University to study psychology. After 1 month, I quit it because I discovered that that was a little bit too hard for me. That was not my call in life. Then I entered the Baptist Theological Seminary. The first year was there, fantastic. And I felt that I want to be a pastor. In the end of the second year, the director of the seminary kicked me out from the seminary. He called me to his office and he said, "Ēriks, let me be honest with you. I have been watching you and you know we here are preparing pastors. But I don't see a pastor in you." And at that moment, I was very, very happy. because if the first year was fantastic, the second year somehow turned to be boring to me. I was thinking, what's my call in life? When Latvia became free in 1990, the Soviet Union was soon to collapse. Suddenly, Latvian churches were open. And people in Latvia, they were hungry for the spiritual level in life. I too was. My parents divorced when I was one. It was very hard to live under the occupation. Whitney Houston, when I was around 10 years old, Whitney Houston was on our TV, audio cassettes, and I loved her songs. She didn't know, but she was my first teacher in composition. I learned her songs to play on my piano just by listening to, because in Soviet Union we couldn't buy her sheet music. So, and just analyzing her songs, oh my goodness, her beautiful melodies consisted just of 5-6 different chords, not more. Oh, so I started to write my own tunes, changing the order of Whitney's chords. And I discovered that some chord changes were very beautiful, some sounded a little bit odd. So she was my first teacher in composition. Years later, when we sometimes, and it is very good that we are brave enough to knock on the doors. Some doors will not open, but some will open. And in age of 14, I joined church. I found God, or let me say opposite, God found me. And I'm very thankful. Since that night when I prayed God, my first prayer, peace came into my life. And I'm very thankful to God that it happened at that time when I was a teenager, when I started to recognize that I have to manage to live a good life. I don't know how, but I will try to do my best. And God will help me. And tonight we will hear the central passion. Passions usually are very dramatic because the story was very dramatic. And I wanted to bring in some light, some peace parallel to these dramatic moments in Jesus' life. So in the central passion you will hear moments from Golgotha path, and then something from Jesus' earlier days. And of course, the prodigal son story is only in the Luke Gospel. So I decided also to include it in this passion of St. Luke. Thank you.
Jesus had cried with a loud voice.